Welcome back. I hope you all enjoyed your lunch. Please have a seat. We're going to begin the afternoon program. If I could get everyone's attention. All right. So, Miami Mayor Francis Suarez has put South Florida on the national stage as an attractive destination both for tech and cryptocurrency investors. This has created an absolute influx of relocations and multi-million dollar real estate purchases. And here to share more about Miami's trajectory without further ado, it is my absolute pleasure to introduce our keynote speaker for the day, your Miami Mayor, Francis Suarez.
How's everyone feeling today? Does anyone have their Cuban coffee? I just got like four shots before coming up here, so I'm a little energetic. That's the explanation. So it's really exciting to be here with you on a Friday afternoon because I'm in one of the most enjoyable places for me because I graduated from FIU. So I have a lot of good memories of this campus, a lot of stories I cannot tell you. But you'll find out about one day. And then I'm talking about one of my favorite subjects, which is, of course, Miami real estate. And so, you know, it's kind of hard to think about where you start this conversation. You know, in the intro points, they talk about, let's talk about the last 2 years. But for me, really, the story begins much, much before that. See, I was elected in November of 2009 to the City Commission. And just to take you back to that moment, I was elected, by the way, by 260 votes. So maybe a little bit about the same amount of people in the audience here. That same number of people would have decided not to go out and vote, I probably wouldn't be up here on the stage, which just gives you a perspective of how our democracy works and why it's so important that on Tuesday, no matter what you believe, you have to exercise your right to vote, which is fundamental to our democracy. So please, please do that. I'm asking you, I'm begging you for that. So here I am. I am 32 years old, a real estate lawyer, okay? And I get elected to run a $600 million budget with about 3,500 employees and four labor unions. And it was broke. It was broke on day one. We had what they call a do-nothing deficit of $115 million. Meaning if we did nothing, we're gonna lose $115 million. And I think it's important to talk about that moment in the context of this moment because something happened in that moment that was very, very anomalous, but very relevant to this group, which is that the real estate market bubble burst. If you guys remember in 2008, 2009, you had all these, they call them ninja loans, and everyone's laughing because you know exactly, no income, no asset verification loans. People borrowing more than 100%. Remember those? He's laughing because he remembers those deals. And so we had this overheated housing market, and something happened in the history of Miami that had never happened before. Miami lost value. It lost 20% of its value in 1 year. So when you think about today, and that's why I wanted to go back to that moment, and to contextualize what's happening today, we lost 20% of our value. So what did we do? Did we raise taxes? Did we pass on that pain to our residents? Nope. We decided we were gonna do something very difficult, which is we asked our employees to sacrifice. We cut their salaries and their pensions. It was not easy. These are people who work very hard and who tried, just like all of us, to send their kids to good schools and you know, care tremendously about the city and the organization. So it was not easy. But we balanced our budget. We had $13 million in reserves. I'll never forget. And we were literally down to nothing. And $13 million may sound like a lot of money, but when you're running a $600 million budget, if you have a hurricane, you're in trouble. If you have trouble with depression, you're in trouble. So we had to pray that and we got through that year. Fast forward to this year, my first 2 years before the last 2 years, so I'm going to contextualize again. First 2 years, we grew 8.5% and 10.5% pre-pandemic. So when you think about, and what does that mean? What does that number mean, 8.5%, 10.5%? Well, it's an amalgamation of two numbers. One of them is new construction, things that are being built, as you can see, third largest skyline in America. Number two is property value appreciation. And understanding that property value appreciation is limited. Why is it limited? Well, you have something called the homestead protection. So for people who live in their home, you cannot increase the value, taxable value of their home by more than 3% in any given year. So we have a limit. And now for commercial property, I believe it's 10%. Am I right about that?
Yeah.
Okay. So we have these limits, which by the way are good. I think they're good for our society, but they do create revenue constraints for us. So that 8.5% and 10% is a combination of those two factors together. Then all of a sudden, March 12th, 2020 happens. Does anybody know what happened on March 12th, 2020? Why are you guys laughing? You guys know what happened on March 12th, 2020? I got COVID. Yeah. I was the first person in Dade County. The first person in Dade County that tested positive. I draw that distinction because I don't think I was the first person that had COVID. I just think I was the first person that tested positive. That is another funny story, but I'm not going to tell that story today. But we went into a worldwide pandemic. And so for most people, when you see a global financial crisis like 2008, 2009, global pandemic, what does that mean? It's usually not good news. It certainly isn't good news for base industries like real estate. Why was Miami different? Well, I think we were different for a variety of reasons. I think the first reason why we were different was because right before that, whether you like it or don't like it, and I say like it or don't like it because it's, you know, it's a partisan issue sometimes, the U.S. Congress and the President of the United States decided to take away the SALT deduction from areas that have high state and local taxes, SALT, state and local taxes. And so what that meant is places like New York, places like Illinois, places like California, you were literally paying more than 50% of your income in taxes. When you compare, and particularly at scale, and you know what I mean by at scale, meaning at the higher end, that obviously means that for some people, that is hundreds of millions of dollars. And so that was one macro tailwind for the city, a macro headwind for these other cities. The second thing that happened, obviously, during COVID is, and again, I'm not trying to make a political statement, I'm trying to make a factual statement, is that, you know, we were considered to be relatively open while other cities were considered to be relatively closed. Remote work phenomenon also occurred. And in remote work, you were able to work from anywhere and keep the same job. So what happened? A lot of people who were born in Miami, who went to high school in Miami, who went to college somewhere else, or got a job somewhere else, came back home. And what did they discover when they came back home? Man, was this a different place. The collisions that they were making in the coffee shop, in the Barry's boot camp, right, in different parts of the city were just different. Different caliber of people, different amount of capital, etc. So I think that was factor number three. And I think factor number four, you're looking at it. I think factor number four, and I'll desenvolverlo un poquito, right? I'll explain what I mean. I met today with Amazon. And in New York, right around the same time, they won the HQ2 prize. How many of you remember that? 50,000 high-paying jobs. And you know what New York did? New York said? No, thank you. In San Francisco, right around the same time, an elected official said, F Elon Musk. And you know what he said? Message received. I'm out of here. Right? And right around the same time, and actually December 4th of 2020, how many of you know that date? December 4th, 2020, it was a Friday, I believe. And I was going home, not too different from today. And I get home and I'm exhausted, as I am right now, 4 Cuban coffees later. And I'm in bed, and all of a sudden I see this tweet come across my timeline. Hey, what if we move Silicon Valley to Miami? Light bulb. Like, we've been trying to do this for 10 years in this community. We've been trying to create a technology ecosystem because we understand that for us to thrive and to grow in an increasingly disruptive economy that is changing from industrial to more highly digital, we have to compete in that economy. We can't just sit back and hope that we're going to survive without competition. So I responded very innocently, how can I help? But what was sort of unique about it was that we were attitudinally different. We had a different attitude. We wanted people who were successful here. That's part of our, you know, sort of core value. So many of us came to this country out of a trauma that is socialism or communism in the country of birth. And so for us, we're fundamentally pro-America. We fundamentally believe that if you work hard, that if you study, you're going to be able to make it in this country. You're going to be able to succeed. And that's part of who we are, and we embrace that. And so I think that was just a different narrative. And so in the last 24 months, to come to the point, right, in the last 24 months, what have we seen? We've seen nothing short of miraculous. In fact, I call it the Miami Miracle. We've seen $2.5 trillion of assets under managed companies move to Miami. Companies like Citadel, maybe interviewing Ken Griffin on Monday. Companies like Blackstone. I had Steve Schwartzman call me and tell me, we're increasing our FTEs, our full-time employees, by 400%, and they've been in Miami for like 2 years. Okay? Companies like Millennium that are taking 100,000 feet in the Sabado Bank building in Miami and are employing over 1,000 people that they're bringing. Companies like FTX have spent $200 million on naming the arena and move their corporate headquarters, their U.S. headquarters, from Chicago to Miami. Funds like Thoma Bravo, T1 Capital, CI Financial, so on and so forth. What has it meant for Miami real estate? Prices are going up, both on the appreciation side and, unfortunately, for some and for many, on the rental increase side. Now, rental increases is not a Miami phenomenon. This is a national phenomenon that's based on historic inflation, frankly. And we're seeing in urban America, rents increase by 20% plus. The problem is in Miami, there's hyper demand. And so the rents are increasing by probably more than 30%. We're probably one of the highest, if not the highest, rental increase markets in the country. And in terms of purchasing, we grew last year almost a record 12%. So when we were talking about growing 10.5% and 8.5%, which seemed pretty incredible pre-pandemic, we actually grew last year 12% and broke a record. It's the second most growth since in basically recorded history. We had 13.1% in 2015. So what does the future look for Miami? When people ask me, when people are coming down here, BlackRock, KKR, they're all looking at Miami now, what do I tell them? What does it look like? What's the future? How do you analyze all this? And for me, the way you analyze it is you stick to the facts, the KPIs, right? So fact number one, Miami has the ability to grow the city of Miami, city proper, right? Which is just one of 34 cities in Dade County, 2.8 million population Dade County. Miami is somewhere in the 600,000 with daytime population, probably over a million and a half with people who work in the city. We have the ability to grow 10x, 10 times larger than we are. So we have about 185,000 dwelling units, and we have the ability to go to about a million 500,000. That's just the delta between what our zoning code allows and what's actually built. If you all know about our zoning code, which many of you have probably studied, it's a form-based code which projects out into the future. If you're a property owner, you can buy a property and you can build to the top of the zoning code without asking the city for anything other than a permit, which is the genius of the code. But when you when you look at that delta between what's built and what can be built, it's a 10-to-1 multiple. So that bodes well for us vis-a-vis New York and San Francisco. New York that's built out, San Francisco that's artificially constrained. It gives us the ability to continue to supply. We have in the pipeline right now, and we're fact-checking where this number because it's a little stale, but it's about 47,000 residential units in our pipeline, which means we're going to grow in the next 2 to 3 years about 25% bigger. We've got about 6 million square feet on the commercial side. I think that number is a little bit of an underestimate, an undercount, just based on some buildings that I know are coming online and new entitlements that we've done in the last 6 months. So there isn't a city, in my opinion, in the U.S., based on my analysis and based on the things that I've seen, that has a brighter future, that isn't just well-positioned for the moment, but is well-positioned for a good 10 to 20 years, so long as we do everything right. What have we done on the city side? Our formula for success has been simple. We keep taxes low. I lower taxes to the lowest rate in the history of our government. We keep people safe. We're about to finish the year. Knock on wood. With one of the lowest per capita homicide rates in our history. And lean into innovation. We're number one in the nation in tech job growth. We're number one in wage growth. We're number one in tech job growth. Imagine Miami, if I would have sat here 10 years ago and told you we're going to be number one in the nation in tech job growth, you would have laughed me off the stage. You would have said, listen, the straitjacket is waiting for you in the back there. Go ahead and put it on, snug. And we have a nice place for you so you can hang out for a little while. Right? That's what, that would have been the reaction, but we have made it happen. We've made it happen as a community. We've made it happen by believing in ourselves and believing in something very simple, which is the American dream. And so the future looks great. What are the challenges? The challenges are, first of all, Mother Nature. We see the wrath of Mother Nature, you know, sort of up close with Ian. It's devastating effect. What we saw, not just with Ian, but with Dorian that came before, I don't know if you guys remember Dorian, it didn't hit us, thankfully. It hit the Bahamas for 2 days straight. Category 5, 2 days. Does anybody know what the storm surge was? 20 to 25 feet. That's 2 stories, guys. Over 2 stories. Almost 3 stories in storm surge. And storm surge is different from wind. You guys remember Hurricane Andrew in 1992, 200 mile per hour winds. That's pretty hard to deal with, but we've increased our building codes and we've hardened ourselves, right? And everyone has impact windows or you have shutters in their home. So we can manage the wind, but the force of 25-foot storm surge, or 15 in the case of Ian, 15-foot storm surge, and I saw the devastation up close. We have not developed systems yet to deal with that kind of devastation. So that's something that we have to be realistic about. That's something that we have to be understanding. We're dedicating a lot of resources. FEMA just downgraded our risk profile, believe it or not, in the city of Miami because we've made investments. We've invested tens of millions of dollars. We're going to invest hundreds of millions of dollars. The state's giving us money. Hopefully the federal government will give us money through its infrastructure bill, right? And so that we can continue to be more resilient. I can tell you a stat that will probably surprise you. New York has suffered more hurricane damage in the last 10 years than Miami has. And that's because we have systematically hardened ourselves, and we have to continue to do that. So that's one of the threats. Another one is like a SWOT analysis, right? Another one is transportation, right? As we grow, particularly in that 10X vision, you have to think about how we're going to manage that growth, how we're going to move around. And for me, I think part of the failure of our analysis is we underappreciate our innovation, our innovative spirit. What do I mean by that? Well, there are solutions today that we didn't have yesterday, right? Micromobility is a major solution right now, scooters. Urban air mobility is something that's on the short-term horizon, us actually using our airways to get around. It's inexpensive because you don't have to build all this infrastructure. We talk about light rail and heavy rail and metro mover and all that stuff. It costs hundreds of millions of dollars. If you can just go, you know, without having to spend anything on infrastructure, you're disrupting significantly transportation. Remote work. How many people here are actually remote working? I don't know how many there are. I don't know if this is a high number or a small number. Anyone? Don't be ashamed. Don't be shy. If you're remote working, you can raise your hand. Okay. So it's actually, you're kind of getting a little bit more courageous. It's probably about 20% from what I can look at quickly. So there's remote work. That's 20% less cars on the road. Right? And obviously, we're looking at other technologies like boring tunnels. We are in the process of doing some geotechnical work on some of the stuff that Elon Musk is doing in Las Vegas to make sure that it's adaptable to our subsoil. It's not really the water table. People ask me oftentimes, is the water table a problem? It's not so much the water table. The tunnels that are built in Las Vegas, actually, believe it or not, are actually underwater. Most people think there's no water in the desert. There actually is. It's at 18 feet. So that's not the issue. The issue is it's the density of the subsoil, right? So we have limestone, they have sand and shale, which is super dense to shale and super not dense to sand, right? So there's some issues there. And then I think the third thing that we're trying to manage as a city is education. It's education. We live in a highly disruptive world. How are we educating ourselves? How are we educating our children, our grandchildren, our unborn great-grandchildren? Maybe some of you have great-grandchildren. How are we doing that in this hyper-dynamic environment? What are we doing? Are we changing? Are we meeting that challenge? Are we pushing ourselves to be excellent? Those are questions that I ask myself every day. What am I doing to try to create that level of excellence? What am I doing to challenge even my own institution to take it to the next level? And I think, unfortunately or fortunately, the answer to that question is going to determine, in large part, our ability to succeed or fail. So those are some of the challenges that we have, but I can tell you that whenever I talk to people, they are inspired, they are excited, and I don't just mean here in the US, I mean everywhere in the world, and everybody everywhere in the world is talking about us. They're talking about us. I'm telling you, from the highest people you read about in the newspaper all over the world are paying attention. They know what's happening here. They come here, they see it, they read about it, and it's impressive. So I just want to thank you. At the end of the day, I want to thank you for giving me the opportunity to be a part of this community that I love, giving me the opportunity to serve you, to give you everything that I have, every piece of me, every fiber of my being, to allow myself to grow and progress and develop into the best version of myself, to give you more, to make our community the very best that it can be. And I owe it to you. You've allowed me to live my dream.